Moinsen, this is Sebastian, and for my cousin's wedding, I created a bullet time video booth. So in case you are confused about what you just saw, let me explain what a bullet time video booth is. The bullet time effect is a special effect famously introduced in 1999 with the movie The Matrix. An array of cameras is triggered simultaneously, and if you play back the individual pictures as a movie, it looks like the camera is moving while objects are frozen in time. Now, when my cousin asked me if I could build a photo booth for his wedding, where guests could create fun memories with props like hats and giant glasses, I wanted to try something fancier. A video booth with a bullet time effect. The upper screen shows previous recordings and instructions, and the lower one shows a preview of the main camera. The guests then press the green button, and after a short countdown, all 12 cameras trigger to create the bullet time shot. At the same time, the main camera starts recording, and after 5 seconds, that recording stops, and the 12 cameras are triggered again. The result is a collection of short clips with bullet time transitions in between. At that point, you might ask, why do you only use the bullet time effect for the transitions between clips? Well, on one hand, it gives the guests more opportunity to express themselves, as they can actually move instead of being frozen in time. But, if I am honest, it is mostly because of the same reason that you rarely see good hobbyist bullet time rigs even today. Bullet time is bloody expensive. If each camera takes a single frame for the video, then you have to invest 25 cameras per second. And yes, there are many camera alternatives today. Phone cameras are not too bad now, there are some interesting Raspberry Pi cam options as well as action cams, and so on and so on. But I found that the best compromise of image quality, decent control over settings, availability and price are old mainstream DSLRs. And by old, I mean the kind of old that stacks up on Craigslist, where the seller almost forgot that his old camera is still listed when I finally message him to explain that no one else is ever going to buy that camera and that he should suck up with my 50 bucks and be happy to sell it all. So, I picked the Canon EOS 400D, also known as the EOS KISS Digital X or EOS Rebel XTi. But even with this old beginner's DSLR from 2006 and its mediocre kit lens, the price of 25 DSLRs per second is still a bit steep for such a project. So, my bullet time video booth only has 12 of them. 12 old Canons for the bullet time effect and the old Sony A5000 that some of you might recognize from my older video, in which I had to dance through some hacks and workarounds to get a clean video signal to a cheap HDMI grabber. By the way, since the Canons are taking photos, the bullet time part actually exceeds a 4K resolution, but the A5000 and the cheap HDMI grabber actually limit it to a 1080p recording with average quality. Wait, 12 cameras at 25 fps isn't even half a second of bullet time. But the footage you've seen looked like more, didn't it? Well, let me explain the arrangement and processing of the cameras. First of all, I arranged them in a quarter circle and at non-equidistant intervals. The idea is to give the impression of an accelerating camera that breaks through the wall to the next group of guests. Yeah, that wall on site was a bit ugly, but there has to be a wall for this effect to fool your eyes. At the point when the camera virtually reaches the wall, I insert a pseudo in-wall frame, which is just the last frame with some offset and some heavy artificial motion blur. Then I continue with the bullet time footage of the next group, but mirrored and in reverse. So every second guest clip is mirrored and the bullet time effect before and after each clip play in different order. This way we get a bullet time transition of 25 frames in total, or 1 second each. On site, I create this effect as a preview with Python and FFmpeg on an old laptop. Since the camera alignment is never perfect, I use FFmpeg's image stabilization and its filters to create that extra pseudo in-wall frame. The guests can then decide if they want to keep or delete their shot with the green and red buttons. If they keep it, my Python code generates a higher quality version for the idle cycle of already recorded clips. But that still is only FFmpeg stabilization and only 1 second of bullet time. In order to get more, I later used DaVinci Resolve in post for better stabilization using trackers and adding frames in between with optical flow estimation. Now, I know that some of you would like to reproduce this. Unfortunately, this is not a project to simply clone because it is very specific to all the hardware components I used. Some of it I would recommend to buy for this project, but other things are either something I just happen to already own, or it is a solution that I would not use again if I had to build this a second time. So, let's go through the components to give you some tips and talk about some lessons I learned. First thing you need is some kind of stand that forms a quarter circle. I first thought of some traverse material as used on stage, but that is very expensive. Then I found a beanstalk e-drum rack. On its own, this is not ideal, but I bought two of them for a total of just 93 euros and combined them in a way they were not meant to be combined. This also gave me a nice arm for the larger screen. The camera mounts I picked were a bad idea. The problem is that you need one for each camera, so even the cheapest clamps and ball head mounts quickly add up to a large investment. I went for cheap clamps and simple threaded rods with cheap threaded plates. This worked once, but the only way to adjust the cameras left and right was to basically screw them tightly until in position, breaking things and being unable to readjust. Not too bad for single use, since image stabilization is required anyway, but nothing you would use multiple times. Next bad decision, power supplies for the cameras. You don't want to rely on batteries for a whole evening, so I got some dummy batteries from AliExpress. For some reason, I thought that using ones with a USB connector plugged into a multi-USB charger would be a good and compact solution. What I did not consider is that those adapters need to convert the 5V from USB to 7.4V for the cameras. So it's not as efficient as I thought. But even worse, the multi-charger sees a sudden current spike from all cameras as they trigger simultaneously, and I tested several chargers I had at home and most could not keep up fast enough, so the cameras would reset instead of taking a proper picture. I ended up buying 6 multi-chargers to spread the load, which is extremely wasteful and was much more expensive than buying battery dummies with individual power supplies. In order to retrieve the photos, the cameras are connected via USB to 2 active USB hubs. And 12 cameras is very close to the limit of what you would reasonably read out via USB. Any larger array should probably be connected in smaller batches to simple single board computers that pass the images via Ethernet. But in this case, using the Gphoto library in a few parallel threads was good enough to fetch all 12 photos via USB. Except for one other unexpected limitation. I first used a Raspberry Pi 3 at the heart of the video booth, but creating the preview in a reasonable quality took more than a full minute. So I now use an old Dell XPS 12 convertible laptop instead. Not the fastest, but the guests now have to wait 20 seconds until they see a preview of their clip. The weird problem was that the Intel XHCI USB 3 controller in that device is limited to 96 endpoints, which means 32 devices. Since every external and internal USB hub, as well as some components of the laptop like its webcam, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi and sensor hub count towards that limit, I always ended up with exactly one camera that could not be used. The solution? Connect the USB 3 hub through a cheap USB 2 cable. I kid you not, this resolved the issue and it actually makes sense in the way USB 3 requires multiple endpoints. Speaking of USB limitations, I first also triggered the cameras through USB via Gphoto 2. Unfortunately, that was not consistent enough, so I used the trigger input on the Canon cameras instead. This is basically an audio jack with a ground pin and two pins that are pulled up to 3.3V by the camera. Connecting one of those to the ground pin triggers the autofocus, which I do not use, and the other triggers the shutter. Since you want consistent images through all 12 cameras, neither autofocus, nor auto exposure, nor auto white balance, nor auto anything should be used. So I only need to connect that one pin to ground. I know several proper solutions for this, but went for the quick and dirty one. A few audio signal splitters, extremely cheap audio cables, and a GPIO pin on a Raspberry Pi Pico. Using the GPIO as an open drain output, it remains passive and only pulls the trigger to ground when required. This is not something I can truly recommend, because the 3.3V logic levels of all cameras are simply connected and ground loops are running through these trigger cables as well as the USB spaghetti setup with all its power supplies. But it works. So far I have only been talking about the Canons for the bullet time effect. There's also the A5000 that requires several tricks to get a clean HDMI output, about which I made a video a few years ago, but this is then simply connected to the cheap HDMI grabber with a pass-through port to show the live view on the second screen. The laptop simply records directly from that grabber. One final highlight is the big push buttons. In principle, they are simple, but I more or less spontaneously decided to make them wireless, so the guests can place them wherever they need them without tripping over cables. I wanted to power them with normal AA batteries in order to just replace them if necessary. Therefore, I did not use my usual ESP32, which is really inefficient when powered with AA batteries, but I used two spare Raspberry Pi Pico Ws instead. Only problem here is that their Bluetooth capability is still experimental, but I was able to turn them into Bluetooth keyboards and they worked reliably through the entire wedding. And the last component, which you should not forget, is lights. This is crucial for a proper bullet time effect. On one hand, your shutter speed should be 1/100th of a second or faster, because you do not want motion blur. On the other hand, you have to have consistent light, so you can avoid any automatic adjustments of the camera. If each camera does its own auto exposure and auto white balance, the pictures will flicker when played back, because the cameras will get different results. Therefore, your lights have to dominate. If the video booth is to be used throughout the afternoon and into the night, light from other sources has to be negligible compared to your controlled lights. So I brought everything I have and still noticed some slightly overexposed footage during sunset when the light hit the windows of the room with the video booth. Well, I think these are the most important details. But if you want to build something similar, keep in mind that there are so many things that can go wrong. One of my cameras had a loose memory card cover, making it turn off sometimes. Some cameras kept resetting when the power supply could not keep up when they were triggered. One dummy battery had a loose contact. USB devices reset when I turn on the fluorescent lamps in my basement. Oh, and of course, partying guests tend to bump into cameras that then need to be realigned. The point is, do not do this if you don't have the time to get to know your setup and fix things during the wedding. If you want that setup for your own wedding, ask a nerd friend to look after it. You can start with my Python code from my blog at There Ought to Be. But since it is specific to my setup, you have to bring some Python knowledge and patience to work out all problems with your specific setup. But if you pull it off, I can tell you that you can bring a lot of joy to the happy couple and their guests. First when shooting the bullet time clips, and later when they watch the result. And with that, I'm out. Ciao!